Today we're gonna kick off with a huge panel, but and I think this is a brilliant start for the day, because South Asia has gone through a lot of conflict and a lot of wars, and this panel will be dwelling on that. There's an exhibition in Patan Museum inside KCAC called Measures of Loss and Memories of War, with Ishan's work, you know, Kundadai's work, Kundadai's book called A People War on the documentation of the civil war in Nepal. There's Stephen Champion's work from Sri Lanka and Jonas Bendixson's work on the Maoist revolution in Nepal. So this is sort of an, if I could call it, an offshoot of that exhibition. The panel will be moderated by Shahidul Bhai. Shahidul Bhai, I think, needs no introduction to most of us, but he has been a great friend to Photo Circle, great friend to the photography of Nepal and Kathmandu at large. To introduce him, he's an activist, a writer, a photographer, a curator with special interest in education, new media. He has been, he's set up Drick Picture Library, Parshala, the school, South Asian School of Media in Bangladesh, and also he's the director and the founder of Chobi Mela. He has been exhibited all over the world with Pompidou, you know, and MoMA, and a lot of different places. So, if I could pass on the mic to Shahidul Bhai, he can.
Yeah, I wasn't expecting such a long introduction. It's the sort of thing you usually get after an obituary. So I hope I hang on for a bit longer, but thanks all the same. The people over here, some newly met, some old friends. Initially, Ishan Tankha, he's a Delhi-based independent photojournalist whose work has appeared in a number of publications, including Le Monde, India Today, The Guardian, Le Soir, Open Magazine, and others. Appeal of Spring, which is what he will be touching on today, it received the Fine Grant for 2013. He was also a finalist in the Al-Qazi Foundation grant for a photo book dummy earlier this year. He was saying that he will not actually be showing a lot of pictures. He'll show a selected number of pictures, but and the work we will see, part of that work is up on display. Azadeh, Akhlaghi, she was born in Shiraz, is a graduate of RMIT in Melbourne. She worked as an assistant director to Abbas Kiarostami. And between 2000 and 2008, she made a couple of short films that were screened in some festivals, Barclay Art Museum, Busan, Oslo, etc. Her work is also here, and she'll be talking about it, but you can go and see the exhibit itself. Kunda is an old friend, perhaps one of my oldest friends, not in terms of your age, yes.
You have a white beard.
Yes, there you are. I've known him for a very, very long time, but we've collaborated in many ways. He's the editor of Nepali Times and teaches journalism. He's the author of several books, including a trilogy of photo books on the Nepal conflict, and you will see that work here as well. My claim to fame is that he's also taught at Patshala. Then we have Kim Huck. I always spelt Huck with H-U-Q. You can have H-A-Q-U-E, but he obviously is slightly different. He was born 3 years after the Khmer Rouge regime between 75 to 79, which killed 1.7 million people. During the war, his mother had buried the family photographs under the ground, and he started to study these photographs in 1990. That became the inspiration for his love for photography. He's now a professional photographer. So let's move back to the discussion today, conflict and memory. It was interesting once I came across this. I was talking yesterday to Michelle Bogra. She used to be the chairperson of Parsons School of Design. And in researching the work they'd done, I came across an essay she wrote, which included Azadeh's work for a talk she gave in Shanghai earlier. And she was mentioning something very interesting. She was a school child when John F. Kennedy was assassinated. and they had been told to return from school. She didn't know why, but she knew that that was only done when something bad had happened, something big had happened, usually bad. What she remembers of that period were all the people, particularly the women, lined up on the porches of the houses, some wearing aprons, some in whatever clothes they might be wearing, very sad, very somber, waiting and waiting. And she walked through. It was much later she understood the significance of that event. But one of the things that was very interesting was that in all the representation of the assassination of Kennedy, none of these images, the images of ordinary people reacting to the enormity of something that has happened, were present. The images that were present were of the assassination itself and some of the associated images. In many cases, we've got that, we'll find in Azadeh's case that there are no images at all of some of the situations she's talked about, and she's recreated collecting material from other people. Kim's work, of course, is very personal. He picks up his own mother's work, which was buried. And I can relate to that. In 1971, when we were under occupation, we buried a lot of material, destroyed a lot of material. And I know several photographers who'd buried their work for many years. And even afterwards, in 1971, we became independent, but on the 18th of January, there was a killing in Poltun, which our great photojournalist Rashid Talukdar had photographed. But it was too dangerous for him to show that picture, because the people who had killed, been responsible for them, for the deaths, were in power, and that would have been the equivalent of his signing his own death warrant. So I published that work for the first time 22 years later, when World Press was coming to Bangladesh. In Ishan's case, he's of course a photojournalist himself. He's done a lot of work. But one of the things he's observed is how other photographers, other photojournalists, have created images or even manufactured images. In one case, Azadeh constructs images by collecting things, putting it together. It's much more deliberate. It is staged, but it's overtly staged. In this case, it is also staged, but it is presented as authentic. And all of these create our collective memory. And the collective memory and the personal memory sometimes merge, sometimes they do not. And we have a very interesting panel here who will try and unpack for us what that is. What is significant, however, is that in terms of the human mind, and perhaps other minds, we don't know, the image is remembered far better than the word is. And that puts us as photographers, of people who use images, in a particular position. It gives us an opportunity, but it also gives us a huge responsibility, because we create not only images, we create memory. In some ways, we manufacture history. And that is what we'll be talking about. So I'll start with Ishan. You can carry on talking.
Okay. So my work is based in central India, and it negotiates a conflict that's continuing for the last decade, many decades, but my work is only in the last 8 years, which deals with the state versus what are Maoist rebels, guerrillas. And we were talking about representation, and the image that comes to mind in most people, for most people in India, when they think about the Maoists as a man with a gun. This is my own image. It's not an image I would release myself, but if you look at the wire agencies or any images that come out into a newspaper, this is the kind of image you see. I came across this situation once where there was another photographer around, and I found it funny, and so did some of the subjects. But they were quickly told to be stern and, you know, hold an expression. I later saw this image on the cover of a magazine. And this is the kind of image which creates, it makes how do I put this? This is what makes people see the Maoists in a particular way. And I wanted to do work in the same region, but I didn't want my work to be so far removed from how maybe they themselves would see themselves.
Those are the two I've copied. Let me copy
okay.
all of them now.
Okay.
Carry on.
This image I made on a different expedition, and it took a lot of convincing to get a newspaper to print this. Maybe it's not such a great image, but what stood out for me was, I don't know if you can see from there, was the toothbrush. And that was, for me, closer to the real situation. There's not a single magazine or bullet in her harness, but there's a toothbrush and a pen. These are the images which you don't generally see. And I wanted my work to be as close as it could be to how they see themselves, I guess.
Oops. That's not what you wanted?
Nope. This image is also up in the exhibition. And what I found interesting while making this image was this is the content of a regular Maoist rebel's bag. It has very little ammunition. There's a gun, yes, of course, but the rest of it is, there's some letters from home. There are a couple of small photographs, there are diaries, there's a comb. Closer to what reality is, I think. Again, it's about relationships between the Maoists, which you don't generally see. You know, they're regular people, and they're not just fighters. To give it some perspective, these are people who are fighting the government because land is at core, what it's all about. Sorry.
Tell me if you want me to stop.
No, I think just go through these.
Okay.
Yeah, that's.
If you want me to stop anywhere?
Not really.
Okay.
It ends very soon. Then we can have some questions. And
okay, well, that's the last image he showed. We're open to questions. Maybe we'll just have one question at this point, and then at the end we'll round it up. Yeah? Just any burning questions that he might have, otherwise we'll go on to the next speaker. I see one hand. If you could introduce yourself, please.
Just, I think, for the benefit of the audience, I'd like to know why this conflict has begun and what you were just talking about, like the land and how it's been taken away. And could you elaborate a little bit more on that?
Okay, I became interested in the topic in about 2005 when there were a lot of stories coming out of the region which spoke of huge-scale violence between villagers and security forces and a lot of displacement. But none of these stories were making it to newspapers and magazines. In fact, it took me about a year and a half to convince my magazine at that point, India Today, to let me go. And the basic thing is about land. And the state needs the land to extract minerals, which Chhattisgarh is seriously rich in, bauxite, iron, limestone, etc. And well, the state has the right to take land away from anyone. It's something that we carried on from the British. And the areas where this is largely done are poorer areas, like Chhattisgarh. So what happened in 2005 was that to counter the Maoists, the state said that there was a natural reaction amongst the people, and the people wanted to fight the Maoists. And what was done was that regular villagers were armed, untrained, in many cases underage. I've had a gun held up against my face by about a 13, 14-year-old kid, which at that point I didn't know how to react. I smiled. I was a kid. But obviously, as a result of which there was a lot of bloodshed, villagers were fighting villagers. You didn't know who's who. And after 2007, there was a bit of a lull in the violence because a lot of people just left. They ran across the border into other states. And that violence has come back again because the mining policies, the policy of the government has been liberalized. And so the land is being taken over, essentially. And when you don't have villagers in the village, it's easier to take over the land. So that's where it's sort of situated.
Okay, we'll move on to Azadeh. We'll keep the intervention short at this stage. We'll have a more detailed conversation later on. Yeah, it's going to come up in a second, hopefully.
Okay. My project by an eyewitness contains 17 images about tragic moments in the history of Iran from the Constitutional Revolution in 1906 till the Islamic Revolution of 1979. And I basically try to reconstruct some tragic moments when there is no image available of that incident. And I try to collect all the data, all the text available, interview eyewitnesses if I could find one, and go through the radio reports, any article in the newspapers, and in the end, stage the moment again with actors, actresses, and basically work with a group who worked in cinema before because it was something new in Iran at that time. So I had a costume designer, makeup designer, set designer, and everything to reconstruct some moments. And if we can go to the next. So this image is happened in December 1953, after the coup d'état, which was happened by MI6 and CIA in Iran during the prime ministering of Dr. Mossadegh, who nationalized oil in Iran. So this is the first time that actually police attacked inside a new university in Iran. This is a faculty of engineering in Tehran University, and three students were killed at that day. So this is a student day since then. And we have had so many other protests exactly at that day during our history. Even recently, in 2009, there were more people and more people killed inside this university again and again. So for all my images basically, I used some photographs from photojournalism all around the world and some paintings as my references. As you can see, the picture down there is a famous image taken by Bahman Jalali, a very great photographer of Iran during the revolution of 1979. So I used those kind of images inside my image. So if we could go. This is Azar Shariat Razavi. So I interviewed his sister, his nephews, to know any possible thing about this man. And I tried to find someone who resemble him. Basically, he's the main figure on the stairs. And I even borrowed his notebook, which was a red notebook that the family owned, and they borrowed it to me, and his coat and everything. So, and the next picture, please. And as you can see, that these two other images down there, I used them in my picture. The right one on the bottom is what I used there in the left side of my image, and the other one I used on the very right side of the image. Next page, please. And this one is some images from the 2009 Green Movement in Iran. So I again use these two as my references. And this is another image about Iran and Iraq war, and maybe we can go to the next one.
okay. The picture down there, you know, on the left side is Kent State University in US. I use that as my reference to recreate the image for the assassination of Mirzadeh Eshri in 1924. He was the first poet and journalist who was assassinated by the order of dictator of the time, Reza Shah. We had this story again and again in our history. We had a serial killing of writers during the 90s in Iran. So because I could not recreate the moment of their death, so I chose this one, which happened like many, many years before. And okay, this is the day of bombardment of the parliament of Iran. The coup d'etat took place by Russian in 1908. Is it? Yeah. And Anton Sevryogin, who was a photographer at the time, lived in Iran, took a picture, which is in the next slide. This one. He took this picture, and I basically reconstruct that picture when they were actually taking the picture of the prisoners, of their old journalists and writers who was in the parliament at the time of bombardment, and they arrested them, and they killed Jahangir Khan and Malcolm Mutkallimin, and they put them in the well. So I put the blood there next to the well to show that. And for the pictures that there is a picture available, but not my picture. I put a cameraman in the picture, like that one. And maybe we go and pass this. And I can talk about this, and then I finish. Maybe I talk too much. This is the death of Taghi Arani. He was a communist during the 40s. He was killed in the prison because of torture. His mother couldn't recognize him because of too much torture. So they brought another corpse to her, and because she said, this is not my son, basically. And they brought another corpse, you know, from the prison, and they asked her, maybe this is your son. I reconstructed this image based on, the picture in the middle. This woman in the middle is the mother of Sohrab Arabi, who died in 2009 after the re-election of Ahmadinejad. You can see Sohrab in the right picture with his mother. And I showed the middle image to my actress and asked her to do something similar to this. And what happened, the mother came to my exhibition in Tehran. She saw this image and she asked me, is this me? And I said, yes, I showed your image to my actress. And she said, when Dr. Arani was killed, I said it was in 1941. And she said, so it means that people will remember my son one day, you know, maybe 40 years after. So I think that's enough.
Well, thank you very much. Any burning questions at this stage? Yes, one, please. If you could introduce yourself as well.
Hi, I'm Aditya. In the work that I've seen, you've positioned yourself in the image. Can you tell me a little bit about what the reason for that might be?
Yeah. Well, when I started doing the research, which took about 3 years and a half, and I was trying to find the truth, and I was so, you know, in the beginning I thought, okay, it's easy, you know, in the end I can know what exactly happened. And after I did research, as much as I did the research, I found that it is impossible, basically, to find the truth, especially in Iran, when everything is under censorship, when you don't have access to the confidential reports and documents. So in the end, I decided to put myself in all the images to say I'm the witness, and this is what I think. I can imagine this, because I'm sure that the truth wasn't this. So that's why I put always myself in all the images with a red scarf.
Okay, we'll move on to Kunda. I'm just putting your presentation on? You need your... Yep. It's, it should be up there now. Yeah.
Can I
use
that?
It? Yeah, sure. Will it carry?
thanks, Shahidul. I seem to be the only non-photographer on the panel, so I'm feeling a bit insecure. But I'll basically talk about a project that I was involved with here in Nepal. In my previous job with a wire service, I ended up covering a lot of wars in the Asia-Pacific region, Sri Lanka, Philippines. Both of them had two civil wars going on at the same time in those countries. Cambodia after the genocide. I got sick of covering other people's wars and wanted to come back to my own country, little knowing that a war had started here as well in 1996. And I had to unlearn journalism and try to find out how the medium of media could be used for reconciliation and peace, because journalism schools teach you how you shouldn't be involved. You shouldn't really have a point of view or even an agenda. I found out in Nepal that you really need an agenda. And I chose the medium of photography as a newspaper editor to tell before and after stories, because pictures taken years apart really give you a sense of how things have moved on. So the Nepal conflict was 10 years, extremely brutal, with lots of human rights violations, which we tried to cover a little differently, but somehow it wasn't adequate. The format of journalism doesn't allow you to go really in depth. So we used before and after, and using images like this one by Meen Bajracharya from Nepal, of our 1990 pro-democracy uprising, where a girl, just a student, gets up from the crowd and shouts, "Long live democracy." And when we had another pro-democracy movement on the streets in 2006, 26 years later, we wondered where she was. So we sent Meen out to hunt for her, and he found her, and there she is. And guess where? She's back on the streets, still shouting, "Long live democracy." And that's Durga Thapa. So we ended up, while the war was still going on, we're trying to bring out a picture book looking at how the war affected ordinary people, especially civilians. And we made a call for photographs. 3,000 pictures were sent in by Nepali, non-Nepali photographers, ordinary people. And Shahidul and another Indian journalist named Shyam Tekwani helped me curate these pictures, and about 188 photographs are included in this book. I'll show you some of the pages from the book. So some of the earlier photographs of a Maoist victory portrait on top of a mountain in 1996, which photograph was found in the pocket of a dead Maoist guerrilla 4 or 5 years later. This is Narendra Srestha's famous photograph that appeared in Kantipur, which shows you why the focus on the civilian, because although this was a funeral for 56 soldiers who were killed in battle, the photographer points the lens to a grandmother who's come to cremate her grandson. A picture by Rameswar Bora of a mother whose son had been disappeared by the army 4 months previously. So a journalist without any photography training with an analog camera in 2002. This has probably become the iconic image of the Nepal conflict by Sagar Srestha of a woman gorilla on a mountaintop in 2005. We don't really know her full name, but you can see the composition. Everything is just exquisite. It shows the fatigue of war on her face. As well as the fact that one-third of the guerrilla army was made up of women. This is as far as we could go in terms of graphic imaging. There were many, many more, even more graphic images in the 3,000 pictures that were sent. But war is dirty business, and we couldn't sanitize and censor it too much. picture by Chandrasekhar Karki, taken in a slew of about 12 slides, which we printed in the book. A woman finds the body of her husband among the dead the morning after the battle. Tom Bell's famous photograph of the aftermath of the Beni battle, in which more than 200 people were killed in 2004. Mother and daughter are cleaning the blood from outside their shop. So you can have gory pictures to affect you, but for me, emotionally, this picture of photographs affects me even more, because these two photographs spilled out of the pocket of a dead soldier. And the soldier is the picture on top, and he had photographs of his family also. There are two photographers in the book who are anonymous, and they didn't want their names used, and this was one of them. He was a helicopter pilot for the army, and he was always at the scene of a battle the next morning and gave in quite a few photographs for the book. This one by Naresh Newar shows you a very remote high school up in the mountains. It looks like an ordinary picture until you read the caption and you find out that his left hand was chopped off in 1996, way at the beginning of the conflict. So the book sold really well when it came out in 2007, January, and the publisher, Nepalaya, decided that they wouldn't make money out of it and to plow the money into taking the photographs on a tour of the country. So we were on the road for 7 months all over Nepal. That's me pretending to drive the truck. And everywhere we went, we saw the scars of war, bridges that were being repaired after being blown up, and landmined highways and so forth. And the exhibitions would be located either in halls like these, or if we couldn't find anything amidst the ruins of war, like this hospital in Chautara, which was caught in the crossfire, and two patients were killed when that bomb went off on that wall. So it almost became like installation art. Guerrillas, ex-guerrillas and army soldiers would watch the photographs together in complete silence. Former Prime Minister looking at, a former Maoist ideologue who went on to be Prime Minister looking at the photographs. We were overwhelmed by the numbers of people who showed up. We had to extend the exhibition in many places. But more than the numbers and the quantity, it was the intensity of emotion with which people looked at the photographs and saw themselves in it, saw their own experiences, which they then wrote about in guest books. Where we couldn't go because there were no roads, we sent soft cover versions of the book. People would line up to write their war experiences and testimonies. Some things that some of these children would not even have told their parents yet, or parents hadn't told their children yet. Lots of testimonies which were so valuable, it really told you the people's history of the war. People who couldn't read or write would dictate their testimonies. And so the second book came out, which wasn't planned, but it was called Never Again. And it contained the a selection of some of the testimonies. While we were on the tour, we would see people who were familiar, who looked familiar. And it would turn out that they were people from the book, from the first book. And so we would track them down. They ended up being Maoist guerrillas. So this one is of Juna Rai. We find out her name. We find out where she lives. And then being reunited with her father and brother. And we find out that the brother was actually in the army while she was a guerrilla. So they were on opposite sides. So this wasn't just a civil war, but a sibling war. So the third book came out, which we decided we would go and chase up some of the 50 or 55 of the characters in the first book and see what had become of them. Like the cover picture, the boy is now older, as you can see. He's grown up 5 years later. The portrait of the mother who had lost her son got reunited with the photographer during the exhibition, Rameshwar Bora. And that's her 6 years later, still looking for her son. picture in the original first book of a vigilante. When we tracked him down 8 years later, he turned into a sadhu. The guy, the teacher with the hand chopped off, 16 years later, and this is, picture was taken only last month, he's still in the same classroom. The classroom has been upgraded, the kids have uniforms, but he's still where he was 16 years ago. This, she was the most difficult to track down because you can't see her face. It took us 6 months, but she's now running a boutique by the highway in western Nepal. Another picture from the first book of a woman gorilla cradling a assault rifle, and now in the UN supervised camp, 6 years later, cradling a baby. Yeah, so that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sure that will elicit a lot of questions, but for now, can we just have one and until we switch and we come back to your questions later on. One question? Anyone? A burning question? If there isn't for now, we will just move on to Kim. I'm just opening your files. Just want me to have the pictures one by one or? Yeah? Okay. Let me just... Okay, it should come up any minute. Yeah.
Good afternoon. This is the poster of the documentary film. This documentary film, it worked based on the story of my mother. It got inspiration from the real story of my mother. Because in 1975, when the Khmer Rouge regime arrived in Cambodia, the people who left their home, they were forced to leave their home, and many people, they throw away a lot of old photos and ID card because they, in order to hide their background, the target of the Khmer Rouge, they kill the educated people, like teacher, doctor, artist, musician, and so on, because not for them to fight against them. So my father also one of the very educated person, and my mother decided to throw away a lot of old photos, but at the same time she decided to keep some photos, and those photos is in order to remember the member of the families. And some of her close friends. And for a whole period between 1975 to 1979, she buried a photo under the ground. And this I didn't know almost like till 2014. Because like I thought that my mother only hide the photos in the clothes during the period. But when I work on my project that is showing now in Photo Kathmandu, I started working on the project Alive in 2014, and then I start to ask questions and have a lot of conversation with my sibling and also my parents. Then I found out that all the photo, they were framed in the plastic and then buried under the ground. And I did exhibition from this work, firstly in 2014, and then there was article talking about it and post in online, and then there are filmmakers from Italy got inspiration from this story, and they come to Cambodia and make the story based on this story. And the photo on the top is it's from the film. And my mother showed the location where she buried the photo. And even this location, for me, I just found out this year. I didn't know, it's like for 35 years in my life, and I didn't know, and they never showed me. And then the filmmaker asked her to go, and then I accompanied her to find the place. And during the Khmer Rouge, all the people were forced to leave the city and be in the countryside, work as a farmer. And this location used to have like some houses, and the people need to work very hard in the rice field, and everyone need to work there. And at the bottom part is a portrait of her, is after the war. And this is her only portrait of her when she was 14 years old. And she had a lot of photos, about like 100 photos, but her portrait is only one remaining, and to me, I found it's very precious. And this is the photo of my father when he was at the university. He studied agriculture, and this is inside the agriculture university in Phnom Penh, in the capital. And this is what he hang out with all his classmates. And this is a picnic with a classmate and teachers. And this is one of the projects that I've been working for 2 years. I inspired from this kettle, these objects, because I've been living with my family. I was born and grown up, and I always see these objects, like this kettle. And it's very old, and I wonder, because like even it's broken, and then my sister keep repairing it and using it to boil water every day. And it made me question, like, for many years, that why you keep using this old object? And then I found out that this kettle had been used since 1970, so it's 5 years before the Khmer Rouge regime. And I start to ask my sister, what is important, why you keep this? And then my mom start to tell me that during the Khmer Rouge, we fed the chicken, but we could not eat the chicken. Not only the chicken, but even you plant something, you don't have privacy. You have to, each meal you have to be provided by the organization. And even you fed the chicken at your home, you could not eat it. So my mom, like, sometimes she stole the chicken in the night and pretend it as boiling the water. In fact, she boiled the chicken. And what one thing that she always remember, because like one time my father was very sick and was very weak, and my mom want to provide extra food to him, and she caught the chicken and brought the boiled chicken to him, and he was afraid to be killed and he didn't dare to eat. And it turned to be the story, like 40 years after the Khmer Rouge, it turned to be the story that my mom made a joke on him that you are afraid of being killed. Yeah. And inspiration from how my mom see frame the photo in the plastic and bury under the ground, I just photographed like the portrait of a close friend of my father. He was a person that took a lot of photos, like old photo of my father during the starting with him. And I thought that his family member, but he's a friend of my father. And all the photo that I just shown, it's taken in 1963. And this portrait, he took it in 1964, like before he was sent to study in France. And so I just photographed the portrait of him framed in the plastic, yeah. And this series, I show only a few images, but the series, the whole series is showing now in the exhibition. That if you have time, you can go to check it out. Yeah.
Thank you. If you could have the lights. A question for Kim right now, and then we go on to the entire panel. Okay, well, it's very good to have a panel that actually keeps to its time. The main job of a moderator is to use this, the stopwatch, and I didn't have to do that once. Let's open it up. Questions to the entire group. If you're hesitating yet, maybe I will start, because I found it a fascinating panel, but coming from different perspectives. One of the things which is very interesting is the role of a conflict photographer. I mean, why do we do what we do? And I perhaps can go back to Kappa, the great war photographer, whose lifetime ambition was to be redundant, to be out of a job. And that perhaps is what we do want to do. And through Kunda's work, we can see how, as a media person, one plays a role. Kunda also brought up something which has become an issue, and he himself has been talking about it, because often you get a situation where the job of a journalist is brought up, and we're talked to being objective. And in an unequal situation, to maintain the status quo, I think, is problematic. And Kunda has often challenged that by using other terms, like being fair or whatever. Would you like to talk about that?
This has become the main debate in journalism schools in America at the moment because of Trump. How and when does the mainstream media use this false balance or false equivalence and give equal treatment and be neutral when there is so much falsehood flying around, so much hatred, so much bigotry, so much intolerance? And so there are journalism professors who are on one side and journalism professors who are on the other. And as you probably guessed, I'm from the side which actually questions whether, when you have a gross injustice, violence, human rights violations, journalists should not be mere spectators, and they should actually be in the business of exposing injustice and atrocities. And what false balance does is almost legitimizes the injustice and gives reasons for it to happen. So, but of course, while doing it, while trying to be fair, we really have to adhere to the basic rules of journalism. It doesn't mean that you can go out there with your axe swinging or your flag waving and be an activist. You still have to follow the rules, which means sticking to facts, listening to all sides, and sounding credible in your piece. Sorry, we're talking about photojournalism here, but I'm talking about writing. So trying to be fair in your story, ultimately, because the credibility is our most important possession. But I guess it applies to photography as well.
Do others have a question? Are we there yet? There's one hand raised at the back, and another. I'm coming to you next. If you could introduce yourself.
Yeah,
as well,
hi,
please.
I'm Chris Pinney. Firstly, thanks for an amazing panel. I had a question for Azadeh, but it's provoked in a way by Kunda's terms, flashbacks, fast forwards. And I wanted to ask about whether you could offer us guidance into how we might interpret your use of images from different times, different histories that are all folded together in your images. So to take one specific example, the Kent State image, which is then flashed back to 1924. I mean, looking at that, I kind of immediately came up with two opposed possible ways of thinking about it. The first of which would be that the proposition is that all suffering shares a universal character, hence history is of little consequence. Or secondly, and completely differently, we can only access history through media cliches, i.e. we're doomed to repeat and be trapped within a certain kind of iconography. But of course, there would doubtless be hundreds of other interpretations as well. Can you help guide us through how we might think about your use of flashbacks and fast forwards?
Okay. Well, when I was doing the research for that project, and going through all the texts and data and interviewing the eyewitnesses, at the same time I was looking at many, many images from photojournalism from all around the world, like Vietnam's war and Iran and Iraq war, the moment of revolution all around the world, more contemporary images from the Arab Spring and Iran Green Movement. So then I decided to actually use those iconic images. And I had this idea about Iran, how we have this vicious circle in our history. Like we had this constitutional revolution in 1906, we had parliament, everything was fine. And after a few years, we had a coup d'etat, many people went to prison, we have resistance. And again, in the end, we could make the Shah to leave the country. And we were so happy. For 2 years, we had freedom. And exactly after 2 years, we had another coup d'etat, prison, resistance, again a revolution, and then another coup d'etat. And so it's just we are just repeating the same thing in our history. And maybe that's why I wanted to emphasize on this point, in my new series, actually, that I just finished the shooting in Iran, I did this project, not the by an eyewitness. I tried to reconstruct some turning point of the history. And again, I used photographs from all around the world through the history, contemporary history, basically, and also painting. So I used many Caravaggio's and, David, which I love, actually. I studied them for a long time. So I hope I answered your question. Yeah.
There was a question here, yeah? And then I'll come to you. If you could introduce yourself, please.
Yes. Hi, I'm Eve DeMagno. So this is sort of for all four of you. but as photographers and photojournalists, you are not just sort of informing us about what's going on, but also in some ways you serve as creators and collectors of primary source history documents. And so I'm wondering, in that regard, especially as conflict photographers and photojournalists, and this is a little bit related to the previous question, but what do you see as your role in contributing in some ways to the historical record? And how far you go, especially for the photographers, when you edit or stage your images, in terms of preserving the accuracy and authenticity of what's going on, but also making sure that you're building a narrative in some cases, and what do you see as your role in the contribution to like primary source historical documentation?
Firstly, I'm not an Adivasi, I'm not an indigenous person, so I don't pretend to speak for the people I photograph. I think at one level it's me negotiating a space as honestly as close to the truth as I can stick, I think that's what I do. As far as what my role is in this specific situation, I think I don't know if it's going to lead to anything, but I think it's important to keep a record of what I see or of what I encounter. Yeah. I don't know.
I think it's worthwhile pointing out that it's not simply what one photographs, but what one excludes that is as much part of the story. So at a point in time, there isn't one truth. There are many truths. And I think different people take it from different perspectives. And I think some of this has been misplaced because recent trends of digitization obviously brings in the ease with which images can be manipulated. But we forget that the manipulation on a computer is actually benign compared to the manipulation that takes place in terms of one's objective, one's direction, what happens at the editorial table. And it's interesting that the picture you were talking about, the Kent photograph, that became very controversial because there was that pole at the back which had been erased out, and that became a huge point of debate where it actually does nothing to the content of the image itself. Yeah, there was a question over there.
Hello, this is Arijit here. So my question is, I do not know how to place this question, because in some, like all of your projects, like specifically to the Kent photograph and the last artist who presented, there is a kind of mimicking or recreation of social violence or social destabilization happening. Like you would, there is this kind of post-documentation process that is happening. Like if we go through the history, like when it comes to visual documentation from painting or any visual medium, we have seen from, like as you mentioned, Caravaggio or David, Rembrandt has also done this kind of things. And if we remember Namjoon Paik in 1960s, he did a similar kind of video project, like one of the earliest video works. So how do you see your position in not only as a photographer or a person who is trying to document a social violence, but also mythifying what is happening around you? Because in your project, there is a kind of mythification happening, like all, in all of your projects. And specifically, Dixit Ji's project, there is a sense of complete narrative going around. So how do you mythify the truth and truth the, like, vice versa?
Okay, anyone in particular? Okay.
Okay, well, in my images, I really try hard to find the truth. And so I do as much as I can. And in the end, I do whatever I want, basically. So I change the truth. Yeah, so maybe I put something from the future in the costume. I do, you know, I use something from the most, you know, like something from after the Islamic Republic in Iran. I put very small elements in my images, which obviously weren't there. Like one of my images, Hamid Ashraf, I don't know if you can show it here. I knew that the guy died on top of the roof, but I wrote the corpse inside the house because I wanted to show the house. I wanted to show many small things. So it's not the truth, and I knew it, but I changed it completely in the end. So,
do you want to navigate to it? So if I
can find this image. So this is about a guerrilla movement in Tehran when they attacked this house. And after I did interviews, I knew that Hamid Ashraf, the main character, died on the roof, on top of the roof. But I wanted to show the house. So I put everything here. And in uniforms of the soldiers, I used the one that they used in 2009 in uprising in Iran. The picture is for 1974. And the uniform and the soldiers in the very back is about is the uniforms of the soldiers of the time of the coup d'etat of 1953. So basically, I changed the truth by doing this.
Anyone else? There's one, two, three. I'll go in that sequence. Okay, go on. You've got the mic. You might as well.
Hi, this is Aditya again. My question is to Ishan, but I'd like to take off from what Kunda said earlier about having a democratic opinion and sort of when you're investigating a story and you're working on a project like you were, it's obviously a struggle as a photographer to come out with the work that you really believe is a story to tell. And coming from a space where you're working in mainstream media, you're not able to publish that sort of work. So you've been, I'm just trying to understand, maybe you can elaborate on why is it that this work takes so long for it to come out. I know you've been working on it for years and you're now getting a platform to show this. And has there been enough of a platform for you to have this opinion and sort of publish this work?
Well, some of the work has been published at the magazines or the newspapers that I was working for at that point. And after that, I stopped looking for stories, actually. I stopped going with a story to look for or a preconceived notion to look for, which is what tended to happen while I was employed, because an editor would say, this is what you need to look for. And after that, it just became me moving around in that space and not really looking for anything in particular. As far as why it's taken me this long, that's probably because I'm just a procrastinator. to be honest. Yeah.
It's worthwhile at this stage to point out that while editors have been blamed, rightly so often, for not doing things, there are times when they've taken proactive decisions as well. The very famous picture of Napalm, Saigon Napalm by Nikut. At that time, Horst Fass was the bureau chief, and at that was a time when AP had a policy of no frontal nudity. And Horst Fass sent that picture out stating, if they don't publish it, I'm giving up my job. That was AP distributing it. It then went to John Morris, the picture editor of Time magazine, who took the decision to print it regardless, because that was also the accepted practice in the United States, that he wouldn't have frontal nudity. But these two people, of course, Nikut and having taken that picture himself, all contributed to a particular picture which might have died had those three people not made those decisions at that time.
Unfortunately, Facebook disagrees with
them, which has been challenged by the public, right, and they've had to retract. So rightfully, that's also something, the power of the people, we can talk about. Please. Yeah, I'll come to you too. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Shuchi. My question out here is that amongst all the work that we've seen and we've been talking about, there is a constant sense of discomfort with the extremely graphic images for many, many years. And there is a line, line that gets drawn as to how much is enough. But considering just what we were discussing right now about the Napalm girl, and as even Kunda also mentioned, that there were so many other graphic images which would have made probably a deeper impact. But who decides where that line has to be drawn? And shouldn't the people actually get to see the gory impact of wars or political warfare or everything for people to actually be able to understand, rather than kind of keeping it a bit subtle and probably providing captions? Even I think once Ishan and I had this chat regarding one image he had shared about a gorilla woman on Facebook, and I checked with him personally as to wouldn't it compromise the position of that woman. So, I mean, keeping all this in mind, I just want to know how much is enough and who draws the line here.
I think while we were selecting the pictures and Shahidul was helping, there was such gory pictures that I couldn't sleep for days, nights. Just so disturbing. Babies with their heads blown off, disemboweled bodies, mothers cradling their babies and both dead. A lot like what we see from Aleppo these days. So the baby on the beach on this Greek island, was that too much? You know, there was a big debate about that too. This debate will continue, and different human beings have different threshold levels. Some can handle it, some can't. I couldn't. So I had to make a decision on behalf of my reading public, I guess, saying that, okay, this much with those corpses lying around with the woman who's found her husband. That is about as much as I think we can show. We also don't want people to be so turned off that they can't even turn the pages. So ultimately, I guess it's up to the curator, editor to decide. It also is a case by case, I think, photograph by photograph, war by war, period by period.
Agenda by agenda. And I say that because there is also, there are these differing standards. So for instance, the dying Marines picture, which Jacobson had taken and AP had distributed, was heavily critiqued because it was a picture of a dying Marine and the family might have been offended. But dying Talibans, dying Afghanis, dying black people out there doesn't seem to matter, because that's a very different equation. And those also need to be taken on board. Two questions here I had.
Hi, I'm Rocky. My question is to Kunda. Did you find such moments where you had to twist your story while you were doing that? Because we have been hearing that a lot of writers, journalists have been vanished by night. I mean, they are disappeared by, we don't know by whom, but were there any moment that you have to change your story from the truth or?
No, I don't think so. In fact, the safest period for journalists in Nepal was the conflict period. What became dangerous for us and physical attacks actually happened after the war, during that whole transition period when politics was unstable. During the war, your press pass gave you certain protection, which after the war ended, did not. I don't know whether that answers your question, but I think what we were also apprehensive about was during the tour, it was so soon after the war ended, we're taking these pictures to the people, to the districts, where the war was raging till a year ago. How would the people react? Would this set off spate of revenge? Nothing like that happened. In fact, it seemed to help in the healing process and the reconciliation. And that really assured us that we were on the right track, and especially when we read the testimonies of people in the guest book. Then we were really sure and confident that we were doing the right thing. But I don't think we censored anything. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to come to you, but before that, I'll just go to Kim a little bit. You dug up, you know about the photographs because they were dug up, because they were resurrected. I mean, there is this, the book, the new red book brought out by Robert Pledge, the Chinese photographer who'd buried all this material after the Cultural Revolution and then brought it out, and it's a major exhibition, very revealing in that sense. My question is, how did your mother react to what you did? What was her position?
Firstly, when I photographed about like a few objects that they kept, my parents, they don't know what I'm working on, and they don't understand why I'm working on this. And after that, after like few objects that I photographed and I showed to them, they become like supported the idea working on this. Because the object that I photographed before taking photograph, I need to talk with them like firstly, it's kind of like casual conversation to find out the memory through the objects. And after that, if something like serious, I need to record their voice and listen like many time. And then I try to figure out which clue that leads to the memory, for example, like the chicken. And then I show to them, and they support the idea. And I photograph only the memories through the family object. And then I extend with the family of my friend's objects. And sometimes my mom or my father try to find the objects through the villager that keep the objects through the wall. And I make it like three chapters from this work. First chapter is it's object of my family. Second chapter is the objects of my friend or the villager in Cambodia. And the third chapter is a Cambodian who survived after the war, and they got experience to be in the border camp, and they fled to other country like Australia, France, or United States. So my parents start when they see all these photos, they start to support the idea, and they think that this is something important for the history, so they support the idea. And myself, when working on this project, I have to be honest with the subject, with the story, because it's talking about history. And the object need to be from the person that gets through the wall, and they keep through them, and something that attached to them. I don't go through like the object in the antique shop or something. And the text that I put in the caption, it need to be from the word that the people who who share the story. So it's like I don't create the story. Even the image, it looked like creation, but I need to be I need to respect the story, the history, and so on. Yeah.
Thank you. There was a question here. Yeah.
This is a question for perhaps all of you. In this day and age of where we're seeing this barrage of imagery that's coming out because of the complete democratization of photography, everybody has a phone camera and going out and shooting, I feel that is it leading to lower attention spans, and you know, you're flipping through quite, you're able to maybe flip through gruesome images and not be as sensitized as before. An image that was mentioned right now, Nick Uth's image from Vietnam, that became the sort of iconic image of that war. But in more recent times, the war in Afghanistan or the war in Iraq, it's difficult to pinpoint one or two images that really stay with you. And is that because there are so many images coming out? So to take from that, what is the role of the conflict photographer today, considering all of you have such different approaches? How do we sensitize the audience? I mean, there was that image of Alan Kurdi on the beach that is remembered. So what is it that stays with the audience? And do you think that there is a responsibility of photographers now to think, to step back to the drawing board and create work that will make people react? Because are we becoming more and more insensitive?
Anyone? Okay. Well, I think one of the things you've actually pointed it out, some of the things I'd wanted to bring up today, with a cell phone, we can become potentially a publisher. And therefore, an iconic image might not be something that comes from photojournalists, but something that comes from elsewhere. And certainly, some of the most important images of recent times have not been taken by professional photographers. The Abu Ghraib photographs, for instance, hugely important, but you know, might have been buried forever had they not come out. As professionals in the media, however, I think one of the things we try and do, and as you've seen through all these approaches, is to look for different vocabularies, to find other ways of telling the story. And in a sense, this is, I was having a conversation with Christian Cajol earlier, where he was talking about how had Eugene Smith been alive today, and he still be as passionate about Pittsburgh as he was, whether he would have told the story in the same way. And in the written word, we have seen the language of Chaucer is very different from the language of Shakespeare to Dickens to Salman Rushdie to Arundhati Roy. They've all used the same language in very, very different ways, each finding a way to engage with an audience. And certainly, war photographers have done that in many different ways. The way Simon Norfolk photographs a war is very different from how Luc de la Haye does it. And right now, perhaps you can tell us about the upcoming book on Kashmir, which looks at this whole shift over the years that has come up.
Right. I was helping Sanjay Kak in Delhi make a book on Kashmir, and he's looking at the work of 9 photographers from the 80s till last year. And the language is very different. The earliest photographs, which I had never seen, I don't think a lot of us in India have ever seen any of those images, they were shot by a non-professional, actually. He happened to have a camera, and he became a photographer in the course of making those images. Whereas now, in the last 5 years, the photographers who are making work are trained. Some of them have been to international universities, and their approach is very different. So I think, as Shahidul was saying, it is a language which will continue to evolve. At the same time, in the networking event today, I happened to meet someone who showed me some pictures out of Nepal, and there were pictures of this woman who was a Maoist guerrilla, and there were pictures taken off her by various people, and they'd been able to collect it from her family. And I was really interested in that, because in Bastar, it doesn't exist. Photographs don't exist. In fact, it's only in the last 5 years with digital cameras that I've noticed that in local fairs that people set up these pop-up booths, and I ended up going to one, and I was really excited. I was going to make fantastic pictures. I didn't take I took one picture, which I happened to show earlier, because I became an assistant over there. I was assisting the guy take pictures. His lights weren't working. He was using my flash. But they were the first family photographs. Pretty much everyone who came there, they were the first family photographs they'd ever taken. Their only connection with photography was in the form of ID cards, you know, passport-sized pictures was the only thing that they had. So,
I'll just add that in this age of Instagramization, the way to stand out maybe for professional photographers or war photographers is to shine the light on the shadows, the ones who are not depicted, the ones who never make it, ones who the editors never ask pictures of, which would usually be the civilians and the ones who are caught in the middle. Because war photography, war journalism, war correspondents tend to be this very glamorous breed, usually men, who sort of focus on the strategy of war, the hardwares of war, and all modern wars have had 95% are civilian casualties. It's the civilians who get displaced, the civilians who get killed and disappeared. And I think focusing on that and bringing that out would be what we could do to fill the gap. And the other thing is, war journalism should not end with the end of war. The legacy of violence continues. And the longer the war, the longer it takes for society to get back to normal. And we see this in Sri Lanka, in Nepal, elsewhere as well. So our job is not ended.
And is not ended simply by the event itself. I'm coming to you. This is a chance for me to plug myself, but the work I've been doing on Kalpana Chakma, a single person who was disappeared 20 years ago, the case has still not been resolved. And there are many people who continue the fight for justice for her. It's not so much for her, but it's what she represents. The fact that there is an oppressive state repressing a certain community. And that inequality is something that continues to need to be addressed. Over there. Did you raise your hand, or we just... Mama, please. You have to raise your hand more prominently. I thought you were scratching yourself.
Because I'm not sure I'm going to ask the question or not. I have a question. It was 2010, same area somewhere. I was with the Kunal. And I was too young regarding photographing age. I had a dream I will do work for Maoist. So it was a project proposal review session. And Kunal was reviewing my project proposal. And he said that time that those who wanted to come here, all of journalists or photographers wanted to work with Maoist, as it is very popular issue agenda nowadays. So he almost going to, ruin to shoot my shoot, and he asked me, oh, anywhere. So I was so adamant, so he didn't disagree with me. And I said, okay, you are going, then who will be your source? Then I said, if you continue like this, I'm going to miss one of, my appointment
sources.
There. Yeah, so that way. So now my question to Kunda, that if someone like me come to you now with the same agenda as Maoist, or Maoist issue is not popular nowadays, what you will be suggest to us?
For a journalist, as I said, the war isn't over for most of the combatants or the civilians. The families of the disappeared are still grieving. They don't have the truth of what happened to their relatives. They don't have justice. They don't have compensation. So that story is still alive. And we forget the combatants. I think what we found out during our tour was when the ex-guerrillas or the policemen or the soldiers came to look at the photographs, we had thought that it would only be the civilians who had post-traumatic stress. But it was actually the combatants who had it much worse. The ones who could not look at the pictures, who broke down and wept, were not the civilians. They were the ones who were actively doing the killing. So I think there's a story there. There are lots of stories that have never been picked up. Because for us, the war has ended and we're moving on to reporting on the politics. But I think every war leaves leaves this residue of suffering and grief, which people forget, and especially in a war like Nepal's, where there was no victor and no vanquished, both sides won. Both sides are now in the coalition government, and they all want to hide the dirt under the carpet. They don't want to address the war crimes that both sides committed. So in this situation, and there are many other places like this around the world, the media's role becomes even more important. And I think telling that story visually, it makes it more powerful.
Okay. One last question. I think we're running out of time. Yes, please.
So actually, like after 2009, we see this very popular medium called mobile, and like it is being distributed very hugely. And whenever, like after that, whenever we see a kind of social violence or a kind of social upheaval happening anywhere, those kind of photographs taken from a mobile or an audiovisual format is a very prominent thing to distribute a hoax, like a kind of a problem. How do you address to those photographs or those kind of things? Because most of the time, specifically in Indian media, those kind of images or those kind of videos are being circulated because of the political agendas that those particular journalism hub follows. So how, as photographers or journalists, you address those problems where the photographer is the common man and he is addressing a problem from his own agenda?
Are you saying that as a photographer, I should be doing something about...
Your opinion in regards to, like, how do you see those kind of practices? Because you yourself is a photographer, and you are trying to like document certain things where you are putting up a kind of neutral position where you want to project the truth. But what about those kind of images which circulate around people?
Which are hoaxes.
Kind of hoaxes, but a part of a truth.
I mean, I would imagine that would continue to happen. But at the same time, mobile phones have led to certain kinds of images and certain kinds of stories being told by the people who are affected themselves. In Chhattisgarh's case, Soni Suri and Lingaram are two activists who've come out of Chhattisgarh thanks to the horrific situations that they've been in. But they've now been able to tell their story using that. People will misuse it. Sure, I mean that will happen. I don't know how photographers can counter that.
And in the Patidar upheaval that happened in 2015 and some of the Gujar and Pratihar upheaval that happened like earlier this year. Mm-hmm. So there were like some images that were circulated. Even for the JNU thing, there were some images that were circulated which were kind of untrue and partially true. So my question is about how do you see those photographs? It is not about what you make out of those. How do you see as a photograph practitioner, as it becoming a medium?
I'm not entirely sure.
Okay, the part gets passed on to me. Firstly, I don't believe there is such a thing as truth. I think that is a much touted term, which we assume is a holy grail that everyone adheres to. There are many truths, and there are many points of view that'll come from many directions, and there are agendas, and we agree with some, do not agree with some. I think the point that we want to make is where the intention of an image is as important as the image itself and what it tries to do, how it is presented. And you were talking about images. I think far more damage is actually done by captions. The same image presented in very different ways. I know of a photographer friend of mine who was providing images to an agency. He'd spent all his life looking at racial discrimination, and his image was used to show peace and harmony in South Africa. The same image. So I think to come back to that, one of the things that has to happen is we as authors need to take greater control over our image, not only in terms of the picture taking, but in the associated text, how it gets distributed, who distributes it, in what context it is placed, what advertising, hopefully, if we can control that, is placed next to it, and what it is used for. Because at the end of the day, the farm security pictures by Dorothy Lange and all that were propaganda pictures. Yeah, we might agree with that propaganda in some cases, but they were propaganda pictures. I need to draw an end because it's coming towards it. It's been a fantastic panel and a packed audience, very receptive, great questions. I'd just like to take up on Kunda's thing about no one won. They both won the war. I think they both lost the war. I don't think anyone ever wins a war. And it is worth remembering that the war machinery exists because there's an arms industry that exists. And it is to feed that industry that I think most of the wars are perpetuated. So we have to play a deeper role than that. The only other thing I'd like to bring up is when we talk of conflict, it's not simply war that is conflict. Conflict is at many levels. The garment workers are in a situation of conflict. Domestic violence is a situation of conflict. Rape is a situation of conflict. And I think that is a conflict that pervades our society. And we, as thinking human beings, need to play a far more active role in ensuring it stops. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shahidul, and thank you, Ishan, Azadeh, Kunda, Kim, for this brilliant talk.